Здравствуйте, уважаемые дамы и господа, коллеги, друзья.
Hello, dear ladies and gentlemen, dear colleagues and friends. I would like to welcome everyone on the sidelines of the Gaidar Forum. This is the 12th Gaidar Forum, and today we would like to talk and discuss foreign economic activities and strategies of foreign economic activities. And we have two agenda items for today for our discussion. Number one, and the first round of discussion is that we would like to talk and decide how the openness of an economy impacts economic growth, and does it? Why do we need to develop foreign economic activities? It is not a rhetorical question, because many people are saying that. Why do we need to do that? Instead, we need to make an emphasis on import substitution, and the country will be like autarkic addition to the global economy. We're going to supply ourselves, and the answer is important. And the second question, or the second agenda item, is how should the government help developing foreign economic activities? And I guess I'll take a couple of minutes in the very beginning to say what is my perspective on why we need the strategy of the foreign economic activity, why it is important for companies and for government as well, and why do we need to understand the clear policy of the government in this field. To begin with, we can see that the global experience shows that there is no such a thing as the closed economy or autonomic economy. The answer is obvious, because again, each economy is limited in terms of its resources, and they have to be focused in the most successful industries, and these would be the industries which have some comparative advantage, not before other countries, but before other industries of the same country. So you have to choose the most efficient industries within a country. I guess it's a function of the market, not of the state, and they should be developing at the expense of the lesser effective industries. And then other services and goods will be bought elsewhere, and everybody wins. This would be some evident question which you study in your undergraduate courses in the university. And until the middle of the last century, each country would be specializing in certain industry and exporting those goods and services. In the second half of the 20th century, we can see that the intra-industry trade, for example, cars. France is producing cars, and Germany is producing cars as well, and they're trading. So where is that comparative advantage? The point is that it's a different mechanism which also improves efficiency, provided that you have big enough market for many goods, especially high tech goods and items, which are science-intensive, research-intensive products. It is important to have a large scale of production, and if the company is working only for its domestic market, you cannot build this production efficiently. In later decades, we can see that countries begin to specialize not on merchandise or goods or one industry, but on operations. This would be the added value chains. So the short answer to the question of why we need to strive to develop foreign economic activity, it's clear, because when you're exporting, you can build new markets, and export and import enable you to use comparative advantage and to focus resources in those industries which are important. Scale and scope of production enable you to get new knowledge as you go. And of course, another important aspect, speaking about an open economy. Open economy, by definition, is much more efficient than the closed one. Those exporters which go to the international markets would compete with international corporations. Usually, they are much more efficient than those who are working domestically. According to different research, from 15 to 30% you have additional efficiency if you do some export operations. Import is also important, because if you do not import goods and services, there will be no efficiency. And again, according to the practical experience and the science, this is the situation globally. Alexei, the question goes to you. What is your ideas and your perspective? How should we develop foreign economic activities in our country? Hello, dear colleagues and dear friends. I believe that you've asked this question or questions, and you have given very canonical answers. It's difficult to argue with this. Why do we need an expert? Without developing export activities, we cannot attain the 3% of the GDP, which is the economic goal. And the main driver, of course, is the domestic consumption and domestic markets. And domestic economy's consumption. So investments should give us a big increase. But without export, there will be no investments, and real disposable incomes will not increase as well. In the last 3 years, export would give us 1 percentage point of the national GDP. If you look at the netto export, its contribution was minus 3.6 points, because the importation has been growing very quickly. So, of course, we need to change the situation. It is reflected in the national development goals. And we will have to boost our export amid the situation, which is much more tough and difficult than the previous historical periods. Although they also can be very difficult, because now we can see the global growth of protectionism. These outcomes of the global trade wars between the major economies have increased the level of protectionism in those respective countries, and the COVID-19 has also messed up the situation and disrupted the global added value supply chains. Now we have the process of the global regionalization of the added value and added value chains, and now many countries are trying to employ new approach to the production by using robotization and automation. They begin to return their production sites from the developing countries, so-called onshoring, and the new approaches and digitalization means growth of productivity. Eventually, this is what we're seeing right now. And add to this the later years of our economic situation, when the WTO, as the international body of dispute resolution, is not working efficiently in this capacity, and we have not overcome the appeal capacity of the WTO. And we know that many countries, when they've lost their cases, they're trying to appeal to appellate court, and they know that simply there'll be no favorable ruling. One outstanding example would be our European partners. They've lost the dispute about the energy corrections. It was a totally unfair and just approach, which has been existing for many years, discrediting our economy. And international bodies have seen that, and our colleagues have depended on the WTO appellate bodies, and they've prepared a new report about the big distortions in the national economy, with all the same arguments applied to the Russian national economy. At the same time, we're seeing some new challenges. The climate issue standing alone here, standing aside, and we can see that in the last year, this kind of message, civilization message, has become an imperative for operations of many national states. And this is reflected in many aspects, not only carbon tax, it's also the fact that many countries, including that of China, have declared the plans to be carbon neutral in some perspective. That means some pressure on the coal production and coal energy. That means that many financial institutions are going to give up financing coal and coal-related productions. Next is electric transportation, because China has successfully completed their own program to support national electric transportation companies. They've built an industry which is now, in these economic conditions, can grow and function quite well. And next, let's look at Europe about developing a new ecological standard, Euro 7, which would be unattainable for the internal combustion engines, and hydrogen energy is yet another hot topic. We can see some economic rationale for all these technologies. I mean, we will have to adjust in this very complex world. We will have to build a new strategy of our foreign economic operations. At the same time, it has to be mentioned that export and import substitution, as we can see, they are not competing paradigms and practices, but they are mutually complementing practices. And we have seen this vividly on the examples of the Russian agriculture, when the import substitution has really quickly morphed into export. It has been worth of 28 billion. And now we can see also the flip side of the situation, that we are very strongly integrated into the global markets, and actually we're impacting the global markets. I mean, our decision about export duties are impacting global markets, and we also do realize that. And now our main challenge is to make sure that we decrease the negative impact of the global inflation, signs of which we can see. It's a global food inflation. It also impacts our domestic markets. We have to build this system. But all in all, import substitution is adding to our export-oriented economy, and building, producing a very competitive product would not be possible without import. Because speaking about the products of the high value added, we cannot do without foreign components, elements, and parts, which is okay. And we have to develop our importation policies based on this situation, that we do have some reasonable share of imports. But I guess it will be a separate conversation. And eventually, I want to say that this dilemma of being either closed economy or more open economy, you cannot find any major economy which would be 100% open to everyone and everything. And the relation of export to GDP in Russia is on a very high level, over 25% compared to the USA, it's only 8%, and China is 17%, France is 20%. So indeed, we are quite an open economy. At the same time, all major economies are looking into the markets. You cannot find the netto openness, 100% openness. Now, speaking about the biggest global economies, and we are doing just the same to maximize this value added within these value added chains in our country, and we're going to develop this policy. And answering your second question, we will be elaborating about that. Thank you. And now, Dmitry, I would like to ask you, speaking about your company, which is a privately owned company, quite a big one, for that matter, do you have to export, or could you possibly work on the domestic market only? You know, yes, we must export, because by producing synthetic materials, all that we do in Sibur is producing petrochemical products out of the side products of the oil and gas production and processing. Now, what do we mean by the market? Market means all the industries which are using our materials for their subsequent productions. I don't know, this stage, look at this stage, for example, or some packaging solutions, or your car automotive details, or warming up houses and buildings and all the utility sector. We are selling our materials to whoever is buying. And when we speak about Russia and the Russian petrochemical industries, very often you can hear some numbers. We have a lot of hydrocarbon raw materials. We're one of the global leaders, which is true. But the share of the domestic petrochemical products exported globally is very, very low. At the same time, we have the flip side. We are not producing anything just for the sake of producing. It has to be consumed by someone. And the Russian economy, in terms of the global GDP, is again about 2%. So we need the market for our products. And in this sense, we can be one big showcase as an industry, having a big resource for development. But in terms of domestic consumption, we are not as big as a country. Market is not as big. So exporting for us is a must. But do you think you could do without import? No, we can't. And especially when it comes to the new technological constructions and buildings, Sibur is a company which has annual sales about $7 billion. And in the last 10 years, we have invested over $20 million into new capacities. And when we speak about any major technological units, you have like two components. roughly speaking. You have technological part and you have the common production side, and in this technological part you have some equipment which we may be importing into a country and without which you cannot build petrochemical capacities. When we think about the polymeric products on the Russian market in the last 10 years, we have almost fully substituted importation of the petrochemical products in those segments where we are operating. So your import substitution is export-oriented at the same time. The same products which you're exporting at the same time, you are replacing possible importation with the same products in Russia. No, chronologically speaking, I think it's a vice versa. First we begin to do the import substitution, and then we begin to export. So the priority number one was import substitution for us. And by the way, going back to what you have been saying in the very beginning, I do not see quite a big contradiction between export-oriented development and import substitution, because both are the real reality check for you being competitive. And without being very efficient in import substitution, without finding yourself competitive, and without working on foreign markets and competing on international markets, you cannot see what you're doing right or wrong, what you have to do better, and what you have to give up. So for me, both importation and import and export, as both line of business, they would be as valuable. And it is like Maxim when he was saying today about the Russian agriculture. It's the same logic. We are replacing, substituting things which had been imported. At the same time, we're exporting the same goods. So this is actually export-oriented import substitution, although you would think that these would be the two different things. One remark about agriculture, if I may. It is not about petrochemical products, but a big chunk of the Russian export would be the raw materials. And we are developing a non-raw material export. If you look at the Russian agriculture, agricultural products divided between regions, this would be reflection of having or not having water. Agriculture is monetizing water resources. In this sense, Russia has a lot of water resources. It can actually export water via agricultural products. And this is the whole purpose of the foreign trading, because it's trading resources, not by goods, because certain any goods and merchandise requires some resources, and I would agree with that completely. Next, let's move on to our next agenda item. What should the state do to develop foreign economic activities? Because when we were saying about it right now, we think that, okay, foreign economic activities is actually trading in goods and maybe in services also. But it's also the market of metals and market of labor. It's also the part of the foreign economic activities, right? So we probably have to mention this as well. What is the government support in terms of exporting companies? How does it look, and what should it be like, and how? What should the government do? When we speak about the comparative advantages, okay, the country is doing better something compared to what other countries are doing. Again, this is the product which you are selling. It should be competitive by definition. What does it mean being competitive? Being competitive, it means managing your costs, which will define your prices, your retail prices, which you'll be providing domestically or internationally, right? And in this regard, in this situation, there is one part, it's all related to manufacturing. And here the costs would be changing due to R&D, new developments, organizational innovations, digitalizations, and you name it. And here the government can provide quite a big support on a big way by investments into science, into education, into manufacturing infrastructure. On the other hand, there is yet another component of expenses, and these would be a component related to the regulation. The government can make easy procedures for exporting, importing licenses and whatever it may be. And they could create some big hurdles and problems. And to me, as an economist, of course, there is certain very like mechanical work, so to speak, which the government has to do. It's a third component which I'm not mentioning right now. But another very interesting question is how to make sure a very comfortable environment for companies and organizations. Of course, you have different economic indexes like doing business index and so forth. But just how easy it may be for exporter or importer to do their economic operations. It's quite a big portion of expenses, all the more that our country in this sense is not in a very good condition because of the big territory and big size. First, you have to transport it logistically to a seaport or to different hub, which means that your costs are growing, so regulatory expenses are very, very important component in this sense. And if you do not mind, I also would like to make a remark. What I want to say, that I've taken this reproach by Maxim, that using my power as a moderator, I've touched upon all these topics, but this is not the case, because you've been speaking slightly about different things, and you've underscored many interesting things. Maxim, first, I want to hear you. What should the government do in these three lines of business? Please go ahead.
No, Sergei, we welcome the approach when first you give us the right answer and then we follow this pattern. It helps to consolidate. It helps consolidate our discussion. I can see Mr. Mordashov wants to answer the question regarding integration into the world market. There are very many things which we can do and may do, and I do hope that Mr. Mordashov will touch upon this, because there are different strategies applicable in, at different markets. But answering your question directly, I'd say that, well, we have to talk about our natural competitive advantages, those advantages that we naturally have here. And getting back to the EU report regarding discrepancies in our economic system, EU Commission complains that we have lower cost of energy resources, like natural gas, for example, and that drives our production costs down. So EU Commission has some grudges against the pricing method that we apply here. And indeed, we have relatively low cost of energy here in Russia. So on the one hand, this is our natural competitive advantage, which unfortunately is offset by the long transportation lag. So incurring low energy cost, at the same time we incur higher logistics cost. We incur extra cost to provide heating to all our homes, and none of the European countries face similar costs in terms of heating systems. So when we approach this holistically, when we calculate the entire production cost, we will end up with a completely different number, and our natural competitive advantage would look differently. And we need to think about it. We need to keep being mindful of it. We have to focus on preserving this competitive edge, because we don't want to erode it. And this is why we need to be in contact with business, and we need to constantly look at this. Because in the end of the day, there are two things which may affect this competitive edge. So it's profitability, because once your profitability goes below a particular level, then you have to cut your investment, you have to cut salaries to people, and then you lose your labor resource. And we have to be mindful of this. We need to keep productivity in mind and the link between the productivity and the competitive edge or competitive parameters that we have. That's a very important point. The second area is the export support that we can provide. A lot has been done over the last several years, and indeed we We have become more focused, at least from the marketing perspective, and we act with a lot more vigor. Yes, we need to have more clear-cut targets here. We have to develop a more clear understanding regarding which products we market at which market segments. So on the one hand, the government has to help, or let's say has to assist from the service perspective to all our big companies, because our big companies are still making their way to foreign markets, even without the governmental assistance. But if we take the metal market or fertilizer market, these are markets with very tight competition. And on the one hand, you compete with your domestic manufacturers, and then all of a sudden, tomorrow, you start competing with foreign suppliers, and you have to deal with tariff barriers and tariff restrictions, and then you need support from the state because you need a representation in the WTO. And this is exactly why we are permanently in contact with our with big Russian companies, and we provide them with necessary assistance. And on the other hand, we also have to focus on promoting those programs, which or those products, which will not make their way into foreign markets unless we help them, like our railroad machinery, locomotives, and other products which are manufactured in Russia. And Mr. Konov is increasing his export at the moment, but I still think he would face certain restrictions in near future, and he would still have to ask the government in order to get assistance in terms of entering a market of a particular country. And this is what we have to do, assisting our agricultural companies, because the growth of agricultural production is supported by elimination of sanitary or veterinary barriers. And this machine is working. Well, this mechanism is working fairly well at the moment. And we have other things which help. We have intergovernmental commissions, and I must say we are using this mechanism quite effectively. We have our trading offices in foreign countries, and we do believe that there is a room for interdepartmental and interministerial cooperation. There is a room for improving it, and we need to focus on creating other niches, like IT industry is actively developing here in the domestic market, and we need to develop a better understanding of what kind of assistance IT industry needs from the state in order to start working in foreign markets. Like recently, we launched a pilot project focused on tailoring our IT products to the requirements of foreign markets, because there is quite a demand for our IT products abroad. So we have to measure the efficiency of our efforts, and then think about rolling it out. The same goes for our domestic tourism. We need to enhance domestic tourism opportunities for our own citizens, and once we do that, we will see an inflow of tourists from other countries. And Mr. Konov's company is a kind of an icebreaker in the petrochemical sector, which has tremendous potential. Not only can we produce our natural gas, both in liquefied form and through the pipeline, we can also produce and export petrochemical products like methanol and other things, which actually makes export of natural gas even more valuable. So these are the key points that I wanted to highlight. Mr. Reshetnikov, thank you so much. Mr. Mordashov, I would like to thank you for joining us today. And Mr. Konov answered the first question. And The first question to you is, why do you need to trade in the foreign markets? You're a large private company. What do you think is more important for you, export or import? And the second point, what do you think the government and the state should do in order to help your company to develop in a better way? Thank you very much. Thank you for inviting me to join this session. I think I will side with what previous speakers said. I think it's not the right question to ask ourselves whether we can stop importing or exporting our products. Mr. Resetnikov pointed out to a very important fact. Our country is heavily dependent on both import and export. If both export foreign trade and if export and import stop tomorrow, then our economic activity would stop dead, because I think that our GDP gets 50% from export and import, because we export oil, we export gas, and Russian budget is heavily dependent on foreign trade. Russian economy is very closely integrated in the world economy. Energy sector, oil and gas production, metal smelting. These industries will cease to exist if they don't export. And also, as consumers, you are not ready to say no to imported products and services, like Coca-Cola, foreign cars, different kinds of services, including informational services. These are part of our life. If all of a sudden we are unable to use it, I think it will be a disaster for us. So all these discussions, I think these are far-fetched discussions. I mean, whether we can close the country completely, and we don't want that to happen. Yes, indeed, we need to protect our domestic market. Yes, indeed, we have to stimulate our import of foreign trade activity. We have to take measures to protect our domestic suppliers. But this is not to say that economic autarky is simply impossible. It is out of question for us, because it will affect our interests as consumers, and it would affect our interests as workers. So I support everything that previous speakers said, but however, in order to be competitive in the domestic market, you have to export, because open economy has more stimuli for further growth and further development. And in order to export properly, you have to have access to highest quality products and services available in the foreign market. This is the only way forward, and I don't think there is any other scenario for our national economy. Or take Severstal as an example. We export from 30 to 40% of our production, and we are one of the largest employers in particular regions of the Russian Federation. We are one of the largest contributors to the Russian budget. And we faced a contraction of domestic market, and that was induced by the pandemic. But that helped us to export more. World economy is slightly recovering at the moment, so the demand for metal is slightly increasing. So we are making some living here. We are paying salaries to our workers and so on. So we need to be mindful of this. I think it would be a complete disaster for Sibur if they decide to stop their exports. We cannot be a closed country. Because it's actually quite concerning and frightening that we have to discuss these questions, openly. Because I think we need to develop better understanding of the world in which we live. And
вот смотрите, вы не до конца ответили. Вот Когда мы говорим об автаркии, то, конечно, все немножко не так. Так примитивно не то вопрос не
closing the country.
Как я его специально заострил. Говорят так, что
I did not mean closing the country directly.
Экспортировать-то, конечно, надо.
Of course we should export our products, but do you think we can limit or restrict import? And you made a very good point that you cannot export without importing products. Can you stop importing products? I mean, your company. Of course not. Of course not. There are two very important points here. We cannot stop importing products if we want to keep our productivity and efficiency. Because in order to deliver highest quality and lowest production cost, we have to be efficient. In order to remain competitive, we need access to the cutting-edge developments available in the foreign market. If I don't have the right equipment, if I don't have access to best operating practices, if I don't have access to IT technologies, I will not be able to come up with a good quality and competitive product. In order to export efficiently, you need to import relevant things efficiently. This is evident to me. And efficient import pushes us to become more and more competitive. And that does a lot of good to our consumers and to our country. That's exactly the point that was made by you and by two other speakers. No way we can remain competitive if we limit competition. It is the open economy that pushes producers to remain competitive. And we're all consuming things. We all want to have access to foreign-produced products. Just imagine that all of a sudden we should say no to everything that was produced abroad or that was produced with foreign-made components. It would be a disaster because you will have to say no to a big part of your life, and we have to be mindful of that as well.
Okay.
I think I should give a chance to Mr. Konov to ask to answer the second question, and then Mr. Resetnikov will wrap up. You mean what the state should do to assist our company?
Далеко не всегда могут быть одинаковые задачи.
The company and the government may have different agendas, and it's perfectly normal. I'm not saying this tongue-in-cheek. We want to have clarity, and we want to make sure that we work in a simple and straightforward way. I'm not a Coca-Cola lover, but I would say that we should not restrict sales of Coca-Cola here in Russia. However, when it comes to equipment, the government has to make sure that it spurs development of particular areas of machine building, for example. This is the governmental agenda, and from our perspective, we need to build up production systems that will assure our competitiveness. And in this case, there is no complete overlap between our agenda and the governmental agenda. We are currently investing billions of dollars into creating new production capacity. This production capacity will help us better utilize available natural resources and convert them into valuable products. We can do it quickly and in a risk-off manner. But at the same time, we are not using the full potential our own machine building industry has or our own metallurgy industry has. And we need to strike the right balance here. And striking this balance is not an easy thing, like import substitution or choosing particular products to substitute when you have a complex technological project. I understand the agenda of the state, but the point is, if our machine building company cannot satisfy our demand in equipment, then they will not be able to satisfy the demand in the foreign markets. So, let's say if a unit produced in Russia costs 20 million and a foreign produced unit costs 15 million, then we need to find some way to offset this 5 million. to give a chance our industry to start the serial production of this unit and make it more competitive. So I find it difficult to answer your question what the state should do. Well, the state on the one hand should support those industries which are developing and investing in their development. On the other hand, the state should also support those industries which are lagging behind. And it should create environment so that quickly developing industries would consume products from those industries which are lagging behind. So the second point, Mr. Resetnikov mentioned the WTO crisis. However, the international trade rules exist and there are accords which govern international trade. And certain measures which are stipulated by those accords may be seen as risks for our producers. So I think the business and the government have to work together here in order to support our exporting capacity. On the other hand, to avoid the situation when we will face a complete ban of our products internationally for price dumping. Mr. Mordashov, please, the floor is yours. I would actually support what previous speakers said. But first, I'd like to mention one really important thing. Talking about assistance that we can get from the state, we need the state to remember one very straightforward principle: do not cause any harm. It is extremely important that the state does not disrupt the market or erode the competition. Like, for example, we keep discussing pricing on different kinds of Russian products, and there are calls for introducing restrictions in the domestic market, and the price for steel has gone up quite a lot in recent several weeks, but before that the price plummeted. The price tanked. But now there are some politicians are calling for introducing import duties and introducing restrictions in metal trade. And we are heavily competing with our other producers internationally. And if we face restrictions on our export, then our profitability will be impacted and the prices here will be impacted. The industry itself will be impacted, including our employment capacity. Our cost is growing in a very stable way, but I never asked for introducing import duties on steel, which sounds quite logical. Because that's how we should respond to the market movements. We have to be careful and we have to be reasonable and rational. We want to regulate the market, but we don't want to erode competition.
But again, I want to say that it is very important not to cause any harm, weighing carefully all the consequences of possible governmental actions of regulating export and import. Secondly, I think that speaking about our interests of our private business and interests of our government are much closer than you would think. We also want to develop the domestic machine building, heavy machine building. We do not want to be dependent on business. But it should be balanced, right? We have to have some reasonable mechanisms which enable domestic production to gain some footing and to develop, especially since sometimes we can see malafide competition domestically and internationally. It's all aggravated by all these trade wars and the low efficiency of the WTO operations, when some mechanisms are simply not operational because there is no arbiters or umpires, and also sanctions. Силовые машины company, the power machines, which you've been mentioning already, you've been talking about machine building. We've seen some discriminatory measures. Sanctions have been imposed against this company. which actually jeopardized the heavy machine building industry of Russia. Number of companies have been in severe danger. All of this makes us think about some countermeasures and how to help companies. And of course, the balance is very important. I would support Dmitry in saying that I believe that these measures are also right for us. We need Russian suppliers. So we want to keep Russian suppliers. But you need to balance the situation, not to kill the competition, and eventually not having to overpay for kind of services and goods. So this is about being balanced by the Russian government in regulating domestic market. We do need support for that. Like I was saying before, and my colleagues, about protections, about the trade wars, which has been aggravated by sanctions imposed on our economy, and we're asking the government to help us due to those political resources and intergovernmental commissions and the trade rep offices. We know that the Russian government cannot do it all, but still it's about close cooperation between the government and those economic operators like Sibur and Severstal companies. I believe it will be very good if we will be helped in promoting our goods and services on international markets. Thank you. We have only 2 minutes. Maxim, may I ask you to sum up our discussion, please? It will be very difficult to sum it up when discussion is ongoing, because I can see that Dmitry and Alexander have struck the chord in our soul, so to speak. Speaking about the national projects, last year we've done a big work in restarting national projects to make them more concentrated, more targeted, and also the Russian Export Center has been reimagined and refitted, and doing all these changes. Dear colleagues, we've been thinking hard about how to make sure that this support would be in line with all the WTO norms and regulations, not to frame, so to speak, Russian producers, and not to cause the situation of possible investigations or possible sanctions being imposed. And even if one of them will be wrong, will make a mistake, those countermeasures will apply to the whole industry and will involve a huge risk for the economy. So we have to pay close attention to that. I would second to Dmitry saying that we do support companies. And I would say we do not always see eye to eye with them in any moment of time. Because in some cases, well, we want to restream this flood of investments into the science to make sure that we have Russian technologies, and we know that in the moment these technologies could be the best in all the sense, could be the best measured against the best international practice. But it's the function of negotiations and agreements, and by no means can we risk and jeopardize these big investment projects which are being done by the Russian companies by imposing or by promoting our own ideas and our own developments. We know this limit. We know these potential sacrifices that these companies can bear. But it's again about negotiations which can be done and are being done in the ministry, in the government. It's good that we have an ongoing dialogue. We have some hard numbers and we're looking for compromise based on those cold data. Speaking about import, I want to say that all of our procedures, they have to become much more complex. What I mean? They have to be much more differentiated. Let's say now we are thinking about e-commerce and trade due to those electronic platforms. And now we're talking about re-importation when we need to return some supplied merchandise or goods which may be not demanded. We do not have any good procedures. And this year we and the Federal Customs Service, we have to build this procedure. Otherwise, there'll be no sales, neither by electronic trade nor moving to proper servicing mechanisms for the export. The whole world is now consuming not goods but services. or a package deal, and we felt it. We need to have. I mean, the word complex probably not the right word to say, but I would say very sophisticated regulation of customs procedures to provide support to this very, very, very high-tech export. Our economy has become complex in the good sense of this word, because we have a lot of added value, but at the same time you have to look into more details, into more aspects. One more thing. In the very beginning of our talk, you've mentioned that the market is all important and the size of the market is important. We do have a big integration project. It's a Eurasian economic space, which has been developing so far, and it is very important to us to make sure that this project evolves, because it enables us to return the market. We can build our common Eurasian market, and we can see that in the last 5 years, we've seen the growth of the mutual trade by 35% within this economic cooperation. It's a great result, and we can see a differentiation of our export, which is wonderful. We have learned how to meet expectations of, reconcile expectations of different economies and different companies. Now we are developing this kind of integrative culture, which is very important. And it's important that by the year's end, the presidents of the respective countries would approve the strategy of integration. And this is strategically important, and we need to support and to expand this project, doing it by developing the free economic zones or free trade zones practices, which we do along with some other countries. And within the Eurasian Economic Cooperation, we are going to develop this. So summing up our discussion, I would propose the following. In the year 2020, the strategy of external economic activities has expired for Russia, and we have prepared some proposals about the next strategy. I think we need now, in view of all these new normal, new realities, we have to reconsider all these strategies to pinpoint the risks and opportunities in those strategies, and in 2021 to set the goal to polish this strategy and adopt it on the level of the Russian government, which would be my initiative to stay in the dialogue. Thank you very much. Dmitry, thank you. Alexei, thank you as well. And thank you to everyone who was with us. I'm saying goodbye to you and wishing you a great day.